by moving my hand up and down, I can move air. I can even feel it around my hand. The air is moving and blowing around. But it's not very efficient. Now it's much heavier to move up and down, but I can even feel the difference. It moves so much more air. It's so much more efficient. Well, it turns out that as you go down in frequency, if we halve the frequency, let's say from 40 Hz to 20 Hz, then we need to move 4 times the amount of air. If we could make this coupling from the heavy cone of the speaker driver into the light air more efficient, a bus horn is an acoustic transformer. It transforms a small high force motion from the cone of the driver into lots of air movement with lots of velocity. Part of the difference in sound from subwoofers is, of course, the drivers. This is a sales driver. It actually comes from a subwoofer. It's just that the motor system is wrong. It's not strong enough. It's a Choral 15L100. It's this is something special. It has a very heavy magnet, a very large motor. So that was two woofers. One that doesn't work and one that absolutely works. This is a long throw woofer, so you can move lots of air. It's a 12-inch unit. The problem with this woofer is that the cone is too heavy. So this is the classical example. We try to move air, but lots of work, but we don't really move that much air. Well, a driver similar to the one that sits in the T138 or the V110. Massive voice coil, and there is a massive motor. If you put it in a sealed box, you will never get bass out of it. But of course, when you have acoustic loading with a compact horn, then you don't have that problem. So we need some sort of acoustic loading, some sort of a cabinet that can transform a small forceful movement into lots of air. So we get this nice, punchy, powerful bass. We want the upper, higher and mid-bass regions to have this forceful impact. The problem with that bass horn is that a real bass horn is not feasible. It's we need to make some kind of reduced size bass horn. And that is what the compact horn is. But there is a huge problem, and that is you get massive resonances. I found that by using additional damping channels with a placement and length and dimensions and acoustic resistor damping, it works like a much larger horn that is properly dimensioned. It's just that the efficiency, overall efficiency and maximum sound pressure level is lower, because the horn and the cabinet and the design in itself is much smaller. You get acoustic loading that works over a wider, much wider bandwidth. It works much more efficiently, and you get a bus system that can cover the whole frequency range from well below 20 Hz and up to above 100 Hz. And everything sounds great with this nice solidity, powerful and addictive sound character to the bass. When you look at the compact horn subwoofers, it has some size, the larger ones, but it can also be made very small. Like the T6 subwoofer, it is a very, very small compact horn subwoofer, and it has much of this same sound character. And then you have the larger models, they are tuned to well below 20 Hz. In this room I have usable response down to around 14-15 Hz from the V110s. In the other room, in the media room, there is a usable response down to around 12 Hz from the T138. And the bus for movies, the T138, that is something you have to experience. Here are some more compact horn subwoofers. The more recently designed ones, you have a very special one here. It's the T400. It was designed to be lying down. And then we have the typical subwoofer box, the T8016. And then we have the T101 and T140. The V-series you see here, it has this narrow, long horn channel. So how are the compact horn subwoofers designed? Well, we start with some sort of idea, a specification of what you are going to make, of course. Approximately, how large is this subwoofer going to be? And then, what sound pressure level do you want at the cutoff frequency? And how low is the cutoff frequency? The design process is, you create an electroacoustic model of the system, where you model the speaker driver with the cone, the motor assembly. Then you have a horn channel, it's the acoustic transmission line, where you have segments of this channel. And then you have some guidelines to start with, and then you simulate and see how this works. The tuning of what frequency response I want depends on the size and the tuning of the system. And this, in the end, ends up in dimensions for the horn, and then I put it into the spreadsheet, because the horn needs to be folded in the cabinet. And then it's put into a 3D CAD drawing, so you can see how it is. So I don't need to build a subwoofer, a compact horn subwoofer, to know quite exactly what performance I will get, what is the maximum output, what is the roll-off, what is the frequency response of this. I can see it in the simulations. Of the designs I have made, they are finished, they are designed. I can send them to a cabinet manufacturer, and then it's possible to build more compact horn subwoofers. But it's also possible to design new ones. The compact horn subwoofer is something that really makes a difference in the sound. Spend some money and energy on creating something that is very nice and works properly from the beginning. A compact horn subwoofer has this addictive bass, and it can be dimensioned and designed to fit any requirement, really.